Hi, I'm Stephen Sammets, professor and choir director at Lehigh University, and I want to welcome you to this holiday gathering of music and voices from three well-known choral arts programs in the Lehigh Valley, and more specifically, Northampton County. Featured in the screening will be choral arts programs from Lehigh University with our 2019 Christmas Vespers concert, plus Moravian College with their Vespers concert from last year. As a special treat, the Bach Choir of Bethlehem will perform selections from past concerts and also their 2020 socially distanced production. Join us as we explore holiday music from around the world, from contemporary selections to the classics, in this festive medley of voices. Following the screening, please join host Megan Frank for an interactive discussion with Paula Ring-Zirkel from Moravian College, Greg Pfumpfgeld from the Bach Choir of Bethlehem, and myself. We hope you enjoy this presentation, brought to you by PBS 39 and funded in part through the County of Northampton's Hotel Tax Program. Thank you.
Child in manger lay. Good evening. I'm Lehigh Valley Public Media's Megan Frank. We hope you enjoyed the selections from the Bach Choir of Bethlehem, Lehigh University, and Moravian College. WLVR and PBS 39 are independent, local, and nonprofit. Our mission is to bring you fair and balanced community news and events like this, along with our other initiatives, and provide thousands of kids with digital learning opportunities. And we need you to make it possible. If you donate $39 tonight, we'll send you an exclusive PBS 39 umbrella. Or if you become a sustaining member, that's just $5 a month, you'll get access to stream PBS 39 programming. Another bonus, all donations will be double matched. Now to our very impressive panel. Joining us is Greg Funthgeld, Artistic Director and conductor of the Bach Choir of Bethlehem, and Paula Zirkel, director of vocal music at Moravian College, and of course, Stephen Semetz, director of Lehigh University Choral Arts. Welcome everybody, and we have a bunch of questions for you. The first thing I wanted to ask you about was this process of trying to direct a choir during a pandemic, so you're maybe socially distancing and you're using video tools, but what is it actually like to coordinate all of this? Paula, I'll start with you.
Well, it was complicated. We never met as a group. The whole groups could never meet together. So we really met in groups of about 10 and 12. We started first by learning parts online by using some technology, a website to have them learn their parts and then record their parts so that they could prove that they knew the music. And then I started to bring them in small groups and work with them. And then we had to record in small groups with masks and socially distance. And then we had to video record in small groups. So it was so very different than anything I've ever done in terms of having a vision for a whole. It was all these little pieces that had to be sewn together rather than just bring everybody together and work toward a solitary vision. So I found it very challenging.
And Greg, did you have any stories of tragedy or triumph as you're trying to navigate this new frontier?
Well, I don't know if tragedy or triumph, but I'll tell you a little bit about our rehearsal process this fall. We have a COVID committee of our board, and we have a COVID protocol, and we're not allowed to have more than 8 singers at a time in a rehearsal. And so what we did, I set aside 52 hours of rehearsal time from the middle of September until about the third or fourth week in October. And we have a balcony here on our offices in historic Bethlehem, so we could be outside and have up to 8 singers socially distanced. And the Cathedral Church of the Nativity on the south side, they put up a tent, which they called Nativity Plots, an open air tent. And so we could rehearse there as well. So we had from between 4 and 8 singers each time to rehearse out of doors. And that's the only way we could do it. And then, so we started with groups of sopranos and altos or groups of tenors and basses. And then we put the 4 groups together. So maybe 2 on a part, that kind of thing. And then when we finally went to record for our virtual Christmas concert, we recorded on a hill out in Nazareth. We can talk more about that later, I guess. But the singers were socially distanced 10 feet between singers from left to right and 12 feet in the rows back and forth. So it was a very different kind of an experience. But there was a certain intimacy to being with small groups of singers like that that was very rewarding.
And Stephen, how did the Lehigh University Choral Arts group get together? Did you guys go digital or out in the field, I guess?
Well, we went fully remote because, as many of your viewers will know, choir is basically a super spreader kind of activity. So we didn't want to endanger anyone. So we developed a project this semester, which I think was very interesting for the students, called There's No Place Like Home. And we talked at length at the beginning of the semester about what it meant to be in a community and what we were missing about being in a community, because that's really what choirs are about. And where do we get our sense of belonging, and what are the families we have, and what are the families we choose? And we developed a project which is resulting in a video, which we will put on social media, because we have all become suddenly social media artists. And it goes with repertoire that varies from Over the Rainbow to quite traditional pieces. But we also experimented because there's nothing normative about the choir experience right now. So I was writing pieces for them that are asynchronous, that they could do in kind of this Zoom format that we find ourselves in. And as Paula said, it's very challenging, but we tried to find ways to engage the students that would result in something substantial at the end.
The music that you all direct is so beautiful and intricate, but it's also complicated. Greg, what's one of the more complicated pieces that you had to work on, and how did you kind of figure out how to get it right?
You mean in the pandemic?
With the added stress of the pandemic.
Yeah, well, you know, I guess I would say there are no easy pieces. One of the pieces we recorded is a setting of Ave Maria by Robert Parsons. And that's a certain kind of polyphonic music. And So being able to hear, you know, especially when we're singing socially distanced like that, to be able to hear the different voices and how they interact, how you respond. You know, as Stephen said, singing is an experience of community. And one of the most essential things is that you can hear one another. And all of a sudden you have to reorient yourself when you're 10 feet apart, when you're used to being in a small cluster. And so that was one of the big challenges. And it's kind of learning how to do what you do in a new way.
Yeah, Stephen, did you have a piece that you've had maybe a little bit of more of a challenge to overcome putting it all together?
Well, it's interesting. The more normal we tried to be, the more challenging it was. A piece that might have taken a rehearsal and a half to get together suddenly took 3 months to put together. So the challenge is really that everything had to overcome a certain technology. And of course, everything has time lag on Zoom, so you can't sing together. So we have to piece things together later. So pieces that would be normally quite simple became very complicated. And I think what, just echoing what Greg said, the things that we took for granted, and I'm talking about just standing next to somebody and breathing and being able to hear them and tune to them and sing in the same rhythm, the subtleties that we sort of take for granted when we walk into a rehearsal room were suddenly so challenging. And I don't think any of us trained for that as conductors. So we find ourselves in a totally new place.
And Paula, of course, I'll ask you the same question. Did it get easier or did it just kind of stay in the same complicated space?
Well, everything had to be figured out. I'm so used to performance where the flow of the music is spontaneous and there's kind of, you know, speeding up and slowing down, and there's all that kind of musicality that you put into a performance. And when you're recording in little pieces, you have to line everything up. So you can't really have a lot of that ebb and flow. You really have to have, well, what we used are click tracks, which to me, click tracks and choral music don't really go well together. But, you know, we worked it in and we figured it out and put it together.
If you wouldn't mind, for people that maybe don't know, what is a click track?
Well, so when you're recording, you listen in your headphone to a metronome beat, a beat, a steady pulse that you sing to, so that when someone else comes along and they're going to put their track on top of yours, they need to listen to the same pulse so that their music lines up with the other part. And, you know, when we're recording one piece, which normally is just everybody sings together, but we're doing it in 10 different little pieces with all these groups coming in, then something has to line them up. Otherwise, that would just be a big old jumble. So, and we hoped not to have that.
No, you don't want that. Stephen, I wanted to have you tell us a little bit about the Lehigh University Choral Arts Program and also touch on the significance of the Vespers concert.
Sure, I'd be happy to. Lehigh Choral Arts recently celebrated 150 years of singing.
Wow.
We did that actually in collaboration with Paula's group, because we reenacted a performance from 1869 that the then all-male Lehigh did with the ladies of the Moravian Seminary. We went on from there. But since 1869, things have grown quite a lot. For many years, Lehigh was all-male. And then about 50 years ago, it'll be 50 years next year, Lehigh saw the wisdom of having women. And so now we have four ensembles. We have a university choir that is a mixed group of about 60. And from that, we have our group Dolce that you heard on the performance earlier, conducted by my wonderful colleague, Sunmin Lee. And we also have a men's glee club. And we have a group called the Choral Union, which is open to all members of the Lehigh community, young and old, without audition. And we do usually large works from the choral orchestral repertoire. We also get to tour, which is great. So we've been at Berlin Philharmonic and Chiang Kai-shek Hall in Taipei and St. Petersburg in Russia. So we've been able to bring the gift of music to around the world from Lehigh. Specifically, Vespers dates from around 1940. and is a wonderful tradition, I think, along with the Bach Choir and Moravian. It helps people start off their holiday spirit in the Lehigh Valley. And Packard Chapel, we are fortunate, in addition to having the wonderful Zollner Arts Center, to have Packard Chapel, which is a historic landmark site. And it gets decorated by the students. And I think everybody feels like this is a beautiful thing for the holidays. I have, for the last decades of my career, arranged Lehigh Rose, which is kind of a traditional piece and is a present to the community and the singers. So I think many of our alumni feel like Christmas Vespers is a particularly warm experience that they take with them for the rest of their lives. And we're delighted that that can be part of the community holiday fair.
Yeah, especially this year, as our producer Lucia said, it's just one of those years where you didn't know if you'd have this music, and yet here it is, and it's on Lehigh Valley Public Media. So I do have a viewer question for Paula. So this viewer would like to know, what was the last song? They thought it maybe sounded African, and they're wondering where it came from and how you decided to include it in your show.
It's called Sililitsa by Jim Papoulis, and it's actually Swahili and Spanish mixed together language. And it's basically, hear me, hear my heart. You know, it's a very open, embracing song. And I like to incorporate lots of different styles of music in our Vesper service. So I often look to other countries for, and Africa is a great place with great rhythms and great harmonies. And so Jim Papoulis, you know, got his ideas from there.
Okay, so Greg, I have a question for you. So you've been doing this for quite some time, close to 40 years. I think the exact number is 38. And you are looking to retire in the future. So are you going out with a bang? I mean, is it 2020 is like your final hurrah? And do you think, what did you kind of glean from having to go through this on your kind of your exit stage left, if you will?
Well, Meg, that's an interesting question. I think everybody looks forward to retiring. I'm sure my illustrious colleagues do too. The plan was that I would retire at the end of June in 2021. But of course, facing the pandemic and all of the uncertainty, I guess I can say everything is on the table. We're talking about what's necessary, what possibilities exist. I mean, the search for my successor was begun a while ago, and that's been proceeding. But I think everything is on the table, as I say, and we're going to have to reevaluate. There's no way you can go out with a bang. Not that I think it's about me at all.
No, but 2020 certainly is it.
Well, I was supposed to go out at the end of June 2021, but you know, most of the people that I'm talking with, we don't see any change in terms of performance and rehearsing and all of that. I would say in the first half of 2021, it's going to stay very difficult. So we're reconsidering and rethinking, and the most important thing is to have a good transition to new leadership. That's the most important thing.
Yeah. Well, Stephen, I have a question for you. So you have to decide who gets to join the choir. I'm assuming there's a tryout process. I'm curious what that looks like and how you know if someone has, I'm just going to say, the X factor or the it factor, because so many people love to sing, but how do you know that they can really, really do this? Because this music is certainly challenging.
Well, that's a two-part answer, I would say. The first part is for our university choir and Dolce and Glee Club, which are audition groups. Students come in, and they're usually at the beginning of their freshman year, and they sing for me, and I test out their voices, and I see if they have any ability for reading music. And based on certain diagnostics, it's kind of, yes, we would like to have you be in this group. The second part of that is that the choral union is a non-auditioned group. So it's a come y'all if you like to sing. So it's people that just enjoy singing can come and do these masterworks, and there is no audition, which, in just a miraculous world, seems to work out.
And Paula, how do you figure out if someone has kind of the knack for this?
Well, similar to Stephen, I have them sing. I have them do scales and exercises and some sight reading. And we talk about their experience. And you can tell pretty easily if somebody's comfortable with what they do or if they're struggling. It's not too hard.
And Greg, what's your process for finding the right people?
Well, we have auditions every fall. And like Stephen and Paula, the singers come in and I have them do some vocalization. And then a very important part of it is sight reading, because we have a lot of music that we have to prepare in any given year. And if you can't read music and sight read at some level, you know, you're going to be struggling. And we want it to be a positive experience for everybody. And so that's an important factor. You know, I'll tell you one story. One of my singers came in a number of years ago, an alto, and she wanted to sing a certain Bach aria that she loved, but it was a tenor aria. And so she transposed it and brought in a manuscript by hand. She had written this out note for note, including the accompaniment, by hand and in a key that was comfortable for her alto voice. And I played it for her and she sang it. And I thought, this woman cares so deeply to go to that much trouble. Unless she sings totally horribly, she's in the choir. When somebody comes in and has that kind of spirit and commitment, you know, that's a huge plus for a group to have somebody with that intensity.
I've had the opportunity to interview people at PBS 39 who have played in orchestras and different musical bands and formations. And they say, a lot of them tell me that it's about practice. So I wanted to ask you, how often do you actually need to practice to get as good as what we just saw tonight? Stephen, I'll toss it to you.
In some ways, I consider myself a rehearsal artist. The performances are great, and everyone loves the performances. I really love the rehearsal process, and I love figuring out how people can do things maybe a little better than they thought they might have to start with. So there is a great intensity to rehearsing, but there's also a great joy and satisfaction that you find, oh, you can do these things. You do know how to tune. Your voice gets better over time. So I think there is really a process in the rehearsals that's not just about learning the pieces. It's about growing as a musician and growing as a person.
So, and Paul, I'll ask you the same question, because I know a lot of sports players, they say it's all about practice. Practice every day if you can. Do you tell your people to practice every day?
Well, you can tell them. Whether they will or not, it's another issue. We practice twice a week, and that's pretty much all we have. We can fit into the schedule. But, you know, like Stephen, I think the rehearsal, that's where you build your community. That's where you teach them how to follow you. That's where you you know, create your sound and find out what's possible. And it is. Rehearsal is the bread and butter of the whole thing. And the performance is, you know, the cream on the top. But I agree. It's really important.
And Greg, your thoughts on practicing?
Well, I like Stephen and Paula have said, I mean, I think rehearsals are the most wonderful thing. And when the singers come in, we rehearse once a week on Monday nights. And when they come in, you know, there's just this energy that you can feel in the room and this excitement. And it really is a life-giving force. And to be rehearsing, one of the things I will say to the singers sometimes, how many of you have never sung this piece before? And, you know, some hands will go up and I'll say, well, you are very lucky, because you're going to learn a spectacularly beautiful, wonderful piece of music. And, you know, but those rehearsals, I think Stephen said, the intensity of it and the sense of discovery. And I think a sense of wonder that comes into the music making, that people feel, you know, and when you can take the time to just stop and tune a chord or say, now listen to this passage and how the voices fit together. And you can just kind of stop time for a few minutes and hear things that sometimes you don't always take the time. And I ask my singers to rehearse during the week several times, and I try to be very specific, work on this week, work on that. And I think a bunch of our singers are very serious about that, and they do work at it. So I'm grateful.
I'm really curious what it's like to be a director. We have a great director at PBS 39, Javier Diaz, and he's great. He's very hands-on. Paula, could you explain what it's like to be you? In a nutshell?
Go for it.
In terms of conducting, I assume you're asking.
Correct.
I think, you know, the choir is like your instrument. So it's, I don't really get into the big, you know, the ego base of it. What I find is that music making, instead of playing the piano, I'm playing a choir. So to me, it's an honor and a privilege to be able to do something like that. And to have all those people really at your fingertips is a really exciting and challenging and demanding profession. So it's an odd thing to do, I think, sometimes when I think about it, but I wouldn't have it any other way. It's just, it's just magic.
Stephen, what about you? What's it like to be inside of your mind as a director?
Oh, you don't want to be there. there's so many levels to that question. I mean, there's the actual preparation part where you're picking music, you're developing a program, you're managing a lot of rehearsal time, you're doing administrative things. And then you finally get into a rehearsal and you're actually, this is actually a little bouncing off your question about what a rehearsal's like. When my singers come to rehearsal, they're coming usually from very busy lives. If it's the students, they're coming from curricula that are frequently very demanding. If it's the townspeople, they're coming from, you know, everything from, they just went grocery shopping, they had to drop off kids, they had to come from the dentist. And when they come to the rehearsal room, I treat them as an artist. And that's not how they are when they're checking out a giant. And suddenly they have this emerging personality that they are artists because they walked into a rehearsal room. And similarly, they create me as a director. You know, when I'm at home emptying my kitty litter box, I am not a director. But when I get up on a podium and I'm suddenly making music with people, then I am suddenly in this process of being a director and making music. And it's a huge honor. And when you actually get to the performance, it looks to many audiences like it's about the director. And it must be so great to have that, you know, attention and whatnot on you because you've got 200 people in front of you or whatever, an orchestra. It's actually a curiously egoless kind of situation. It's just the music going through you. It's what Paula said. You're just kind of the instrument in you and you're making the music. So you came from a very long arc of planning this to this kind of joy in music making.
And Greg, how about you?
Well, I agree with everything that's been said, you know, and I would say it's very humbling to be a director. I think it's very humbling because these people are giving their time. I mean, you know, the Bach Choir are what we call amateur singers, and the word amateur means someone who does it because they love it. And so they're giving their time, talent, treasure. They're away from their families, they're away from their jobs, and they're giving this time. So I think it's a huge privilege. I guess as I was listening to Stephen and Paula, I thought on the one hand, I feel like it's this incredibly intense experience of community, and I feel so close to my singers and I love being with them. And on the other hand, I feel like sometimes it's a very lonesome place to be. There's a lot of time that you spend alone, you know, necessarily, like Stephen said, starting to plan the program and learn all the notes. But it is sometimes I find it a lonesome experience, because you want to respect what they're doing, what they're giving. And it is, I mean, I think a lot of conductors are not egoless, but I think it is, in the end, it's not about ego, it's not about you or me, it's about what a community can achieve together and what people feel. And I think that's why this isolation is so difficult, because we feel together, we breathe together, we exhale together, we, you know, conceive this music together. And so to be doing that in isolation is a real challenge.
And Greg, that leads me to our last question of the night, which I'd like you all to answer. What has it been like for you to create music in perhaps one of the most tough times of your lifetime and everyone's that you're directing? Paula, I'll start with you.
Really complicated. I didn't know what I didn't know when I started, and just kind of pieced it together as we went along. And as Greg said, it was lonely just being a conductor, but now it was really tough, because I didn't even learn what the first year students' faces look like, because they were always masked. And so I don't even know what the people look like. And so it's just so different. You don't get to build those relationships. People were in and out and zip and zap, and it was all about technology and not about all the values that I hold so dear in choral music making. So it was really just a very different thing that I hope we don't have to repeat for very long.
And Stephen, how about yourself?
Well, obviously it's been very challenging. I think it's, we're all at certain points in our career. I think if I had faced this at an earlier point in my career, I think I would have been very worried about every tuned note and what can we, you know, do to perfect this. And I think the older I get, the more I realize that what we are doing is about creating community. And I think anything that we could do to help the community and help a sense of sanity at this rather insane time was of use. And I could see it with my students. They were so stressed out from being on Zoom all the time. And they would come to these rehearsals, and even though we were doing warm-ups that everybody was, I mean, I've had students in China and I had students in South America, but they were all doing the same warm-up together. And all of these students really love each other. So if we were able to maintain the community during this time, I will think that that was a success.
And Greg, your thoughts on conducting and directing at this time?
Well, I've actually done less conducting in a way, because I'm playing what's called continuo. I play the keyboard part, which is with the cello and the bass in Baroque music. And, you know, it's been very gratifying to be able to be with real musicians, socially distanced in a space where we usually will just have one or two soloists now. We don't have the choir for our Bach at Noon monthly broadcasts, and we're doing what we call moments of comfort on a weekly basis. People can go to Bach.org and see that. But there's an intimacy, because you're just with a few people and you're not with the audience, you know, as much as we miss that. But then it goes out online and we get responses from all over the country. I mean, and from around the world. It's kind of created a new audience for us that we're going to have to continue to care for when this is all over. But so like Paula said, we didn't know what we didn't know going into it, but I think we've discovered some great things along the way. And like Stephen said, the spirit of community and connections has been ongoing even in spite of it all.
Well said, Greg. Well, that's all the time we have. We want to thank our wonderful panel and Northampton County's Hotel Tax Program for making this event possible. Now, before you log off, please fill out our survey. It's in your chat box, and it's for a chance to win a very exclusive PBS 39 umbrella. And please remember to become a member of Lehigh Valley Public Media so that we can keep doing events just like this. We need you. From all of us at Lehigh Valley Public Media, happy holidays. I'm Megan Frank. Good night.